Hi everybody. So far in this course, we've built up from simple model systems to one electron atoms to multi-electron atoms, and really the only thing left for us to do is to start talking about chemical bonds. In this video, we'll be focusing on the simplest chemical bond, H2+. In chemistry, we talk about chemical bonds with a variety of levels of abstraction. In general chemistry and organic chemistry, we most often talk in terms of valence bond theory, where we think of bonds as pairs of electrons localized between two atoms. We often draw those bonds as lines in Lewis structures. And while we do incorporate ideas like hybridization, which start to get at the idea that electrons are actually in orbitals, hybridization still basically puts bonding pairs of electrons between two atoms. The nice thing about valence bond theory is that it's relatively easy to picture. We can draw Lewis structures on pencil and paper, and fairly quickly learn about the number and types of bonds in a molecule. But the drawback is that valence bond theory doesn't actually try to solve the Schrödinger equation, so it doesn't correctly capture the positions and energies of electrons. In contrast, we're going to talk in this course about molecular orbital theory, in which we acknowledge that electrons can be delocalized throughout an entire molecule, and we find molecular orbitals as the eigenfunctions of the Schrödinger equation. Molecular orbital theory is more difficult to visualize and more difficult to do on pencil and paper, but it's also more complete. Molecular orbital theory correctly captures the positions and energies of electrons, and it's consistent with quantum mechanics. So molecular orbital theory is the viewpoint that we're going to discuss in this course. Let's think about how we would solve for molecular orbitals. Like all quantum mechanical wave functions, it's a matter of solving the Schrödinger equation. In this case, the potential energy landscape is dictated by the arrangement of nuclei where the atoms are located. As was the case with atoms, the Hamiltonian operator consists of a kinetic energy term for each particle, and potential energy terms for the electrostatic attraction or repulsion of each pair of particles. In this video, our focus is on the simplest chemical bond, H2+, which has two positively charged nuclei and one negatively charged electron. Let's define the distance between the two nuclei as capital R, and the distances between the electron and nucleus A and nucleus B as lowercase rA and lowercase rB. For this system, you would expect to see six terms in the Hamiltonian, three kinetic energy terms and three potential energy terms. But we're going to make an approximation to simplify things. We use what's called the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which assumes that electrons are moving but nuclei are stationary. That means we actually only need one kinetic energy term for the electron. So let's write out the Hamiltonian operator for H2+. We have a kinetic energy term for the electron, a potential energy term for the attraction of the electron and nucleus A, a potential energy term for the attraction of the electron and nucleus B, and a potential energy term for the repulsion of the two nuclei. In this expression, we find ourselves writing the same collection of constants, e squared over 4 pi epsilon 0, a large number of times. So we're actually going to rewrite this expression with that collection of constants shown as J0. It turns out to be difficult but possible to exactly solve for the wave functions of H2+. But rather than solving for these wave functions exactly, we're going to make an approximation that the lowest energy wave functions in H2+ are a sum and a difference of hydrogen 1s orbitals on atoms A and B. So one of these molecular orbitals has the form A plus B, shown on the left, and the other has the form A minus B, shown on the right. And while this isn't actually the mathematical form of the molecular orbitals in H2+, it is very close to it. And as we'll see as we move on to more complicated molecules, molecular orbitals do generally resemble these sorts of sums and differences of atomic orbitals, also called linear combinations of atomic orbitals. So it's instructive for us to assume that these are the molecular orbitals and to see what comes out of it. Now that we have the approximate mathematical form of these wave functions, let's think about what their energies are. The first step, as it usually is to normalize the wave functions. We're only going to do this for the orbital A plus B, but you could imagine doing something very similar for A minus B. So we know that our orbital, which we'll call Psi1, has this form, a normalization constant times A plus B, where A and B are normalized hydrogen 1s orbitals on the atoms. Since this molecular orbital consists of real values, we know that the definition of what it means to be normalized is that the integral of this wave function squared over all space equals 1. We can then substitute in our expression for psi 1, bringing the constant n squared out front. We can multiply out the contents of the integral in the same way that we would multiply out a polynomial and separate it into three integrals like this, and now we can think about what the values of these three integrals are. Because a and b are normalized atomic orbitals, we know that the integrals of a squared and b squared over all space have to be 1. That's the definition of what it means to be normalized. It's tempting to think that the integral of a times b over all space would be 0. We've seen plenty of cases where the integral of one wave function times another wave function equals 0 because they're orthogonal to each other. But a and b are not orthogonal to each other. They're eigenfunctions of two different Hamiltonians, one of them centered at atom A and one of them centered at atom B, so there's no requirement that they're orthogonal to each other. In fact, this type of integral turns out to be what we call an overlap integral, and often symbolized with the letter capital S. An overlap integral is basically what it sounds like, a measure of how much these two atomic orbitals overlap. If A and B are very far away from each other and don't overlap much, the value of that integral approaches 0. If A and B are basically on top of each other, the value approaches 1. So at typical bond distances, these overlap integrals have values between 0 and 1, typically in the range of about 0.2. But we'll just keep things general and call the value S. So now we have values, or at least symbols, for all of these terms, and we can simplify things a bit, and find that the normalization constant for psi 1 is 1 over the square root of 2 times the quantity 1 plus S. That means the full expression for psi 1 is shown here, and while we didn't normalize psi 2, we could do something very similar and find that the expression looks like this. Now that we've normalized the molecular orbitals, the next step is to find their energy expectation values. We know that for the true molecular orbital, the energy expectation value, the average that we would get if we measured the energy a large number of times, is just the energy of that orbital. And while the wave functions that we're working with are actually approximations of the true molecular orbitals, they're pretty close. So if we find their energy expectation values, we know we're pretty close to the actual energies of the true molecular orbitals. Again, we're only going to derive this for psi 1, but we could do something very similar for psi 2. And while the math gets pretty complicated here, the important thing is that we understand the approach and we qualitatively think about the results. By definition, the energy expectation value of psi 1 looks like this, the integral of psi 1 times the Hamiltonian operator applied to psi 1. We've already found psi 1, and if we write it out, our expression looks like this. We can then multiply out the contents of the integral to get several different terms, and then we can notice something about this. H2 plus is very symmetric, and atomic orbitals A and B are equivalent to each other with respect to the Hamiltonian operator. That means that some terms within this integral are equal to each other. The integral of AHA is equal to the integral of BHB, and the integral of AHB is equal to the integral of BHA. That means we can actually simplify things a little bit and only worry about two terms. So far, we've expressed the Hamiltonian abstractly as the letter H, but we know what terms the Hamiltonian consist of, and we can write those out. Then, for reasons that will become clear in a minute, we can further split up each of these terms, so now we're left with four different integrals. Again, I realize the math is coming quickly in this video, and I would encourage you to slow things down and convince yourself that each of these mathematical steps is legal. The reason we split up our expression in this way is that we know the values of some parts of this. For example, the terms that I've highlighted in red are just atomic Hamiltonian operators applied to an atomic orbital A, and we know from the Schrödinger equation that each of those is just equal to the energy of a hydrogen 1s orbital times the orbital. The other integrals in this equation are more difficult to solve, but we can at least give them names. This integral highlighted in blue is called a Coulomb integral, and it has a positive value. We'll call it capital J. And the integral highlighted in green is called an exchange integral. At typical bond distances, it's negative, and we'll call it capital K. So now we can write out this expression again, and recognize that the remaining integrals are things that we can solve. The integral of a squared we know is 1 because a is normalized, and the integral of b times a we've already defined as capital S, an overlap integral. So we can write this out again, simplify it just a little bit more, and find that the energy of psi 1 is the energy of a hydrogen 1s atomic orbital plus a collection of terms. This collection of terms actually turns out to be negative at typical bond distances, so the energy of this molecular orbital is a little bit lower than the energy of an atomic 1s orbital. To summarize, we found that the energy of the molecular orbital psi 1 is the energy of an atomic hydrogen 1s orbital minus a little bit, so it's stabilizing at typical bond distances. And while we didn't solve for the energy of psi 2, we could have found that it's the energy of an atomic hydrogen 1s orbital plus a little bit. So we have one orbital that's stabilizing and one orbital that's destabilizing. We can plot the energies of the molecular orbitals psi 1 and psi 2 as a function of the distance between the two atoms. I'd like to point out a couple things in this figure. First of all, notice that as the two atoms get very far apart, the energies of both molecular orbitals approach the energy of a hydrogen 1s orbital. This makes sense. If two atoms are very far apart, they're basically separate atoms and not a molecule. So you would expect their orbitals to have energies approaching those of atomic orbitals. As the atoms are brought closer together, the energy of psi 2 is always higher than the energy of a hydrogen 1s orbital. But the energy of psi 1 gets lower for a while before getting higher once the atoms are brought very close together. In the ground state of H2+, the electron occupies psi 1, the lowest energy orbital. Notice that there's a minimum energy of psi 1. That means there's an equilibrium bond length. There is a particular separation between these two atoms that's most stable. Finally, I'd just like to summarize the takeaway message from this video that will be most important moving forward. We saw that as we brought two atomic orbitals together, we ended up with one orbital that resembled A plus B, the sum of the two atomic orbitals, that was lower in energy than the atomic orbitals. This is a bonding orbital, where the electron density accumulates between the two atoms. And we also saw a molecular orbital that resembled the difference between the two atomic orbitals, A minus B, that was higher in energy than the atomic orbitals. This is an antibonding orbital, where there's actually a node between the two atoms, a change in sign of the wave function. We'll find that this sort of mixing of two atomic orbitals is general. As two atomic orbitals come together, they tend to mix to form a bonding orbital that's lower in energy and an antibonding orbital that's higher in energy. That's all for now. We'll see how this sort of mixing of atomic orbitals plays out for more complicated diatomic molecules in the next video.